Hello and welcome to another episode in the Godot Basics Tutorial Series. In this episode, we will be taking a look at the Animation Player. The Animation Player is used for general purpose playback of animation resources, similar to the Tween class in some aspects, although Animation Player does require an animation resource. And since we went over the animation resource in the last episode, we are all well aware that animation resources deal with known values. I want to go over three methods I think will help you out when using the Animation Player. The most important one is the addAnimation method. It takes in two arguments. The first argument is the name you would like to assign your animation resource with so it can be referred to in other methods. And the second argument is the animation resource. With the string name you assigned in your addAnimation method, you can go ahead and use the play method. The play method takes in a string name as the first argument, and it takes in three other arguments: custom blim, custom speed, and from end, although these are all optional as they have default values assigned to them. So all you really need is to pass in the first argument. And lastly, if you would like to stop your animation from playing, you do have the stop method, which takes in one argument, which is optional because by default, the first argument, which is a Boolean value, is set to true. And if the reset value is left to the default value true, all this will do is reset all values back to zero and reset the playing speed to one. There are other methods and properties that the Animation Player comes with. However, most of the time, you may find it beneficial to set up your own animations through the animation UI provided to you in Godot. So in this episode, we won't go over most of the properties and methods provided to you by the Animation Player class, but instead take a look at how we can create our own animations in Godot. Let's go ahead and see how we can do that. So let's go over the resource class that we're going to pass into our Animation Player class. So again, we extend from the Animation Resource class. We give it the class name Animation Resource. We have this function called getAnimationResource, which returns the self keyword, which just means we're going to return back an animation data type. Now, even though we went over this in the last episode, just a quick summary. The four most important things is one, set a value for the length. We also need to make sure that we grab a specific track type. In this case, we're using type value, which just means we are interpolating between two property values. Then we need to set a path, and then we can go ahead and insert keys. Now, when we take a look at the Animation Player class, we need to make sure that we extend from the Animation Player class. So we get all the functionality of our Animation Player methods, which include the addAnimation and play methods. In this line over here, we're going to assign our animation resource into an instance object called animation. And we're going to go ahead and grab that animation resource by using animation.getAnimationResource. And what this means is that our variable called getAnimation will in fact hold our animation resource. So remember that the new keyword just instantiates the object, and the method is what we use to grab basically everything. And that's because inside our method, we're setting up everything we need for our animation resource. And what we're using this is basically a simple function inside our ready virtual method. We're going to use the addAnimation method. The first argument is a string value that represents the name we want to give our animation. And the second argument is the animation resource. In this case, it's the variable getAnimation. And we use the play method, and we pass in as the first argument the string value play because we gave the name play with the addAnimation method to our getAnimation resource. And so when we actually run the scene, that's how we get our thing to move. Now, this is great and all, but there is an easier way. And so with the knowledge we got from last episode in the Animation Resource class, we can actually build our own animations using the Animation Player node. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. So if we come to the bottom screen of our Godot app, you're going to see this window called Animation. And what you want to do is click this button called Animation here. Click New, give it a name, and we're just gonna give this a name test. press the OK button, and over here you can see that we do in fact have an animation resource ready for us without writing it ourselves in code. And notice something here. Notice here that we have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. These are the seconds, the length value. And by default, it's set to 1, so that means our animation right here can only last 1 second. If you want to change the length or the amount of seconds your animation is allowed to have, here, what you need to do is go to the top right of your animation UI, come here to where the 1 is, it will be right next to this clock button, and you can go ahead and change it. So let's go ahead and change it to 2, just like we did in the last episode. And notice once I click enter, you're going to see here that now instead of just 0 being highlighted, we have both 0 and 1 highlighted. That means now our animation is allowed to run for 2 seconds. Now let's go ahead and create our own track. So we did step 1, which was change our length value. So step 2 will be to add the track type. So over here in the plus button that says add track, we can go ahead and add our track. And notice we're given 6 different options: property track, 3D transform, call method, Bezier, audio playback, and animation playback. Doesn't this look familiar? In the last episode, these would be our track type enums. So the property track here is basically our type underscore value that we used in the resource script GD file. So if I go ahead and press that here, that resource type is basically our type underscore value when we use the add track method. So that's what we're going to use here, the property track. And of course, we need to attach it to something. We need to set its path. And in this case, we're going to set the path to the enemy node. And that's what this pop-up is asking us to do, to set the path. You're going to press OK, and you're going to pick something to attach to. So we're going to try to do the same thing as we did in the last episode, which was the position X value. However, when we use the animation UI, we are limited. Now, if I choose position, it's going to pop up here. But regardless, despite all of that, we will have an easier time of setting our values. And what I mean is it's very simple. Without code, we can move our game object, our enemy object, nonetheless. So let's go ahead and do that. Notice here in our enemy class, we have the sprite, the node2D, and we have the position. So notice that there are keys aligned to the right. You can go ahead and click those keys. And if we look back at the UI, it sets up a keyframe. And that's basically like inserting a keyframe, just like we did in the last episode. However, we're not using code for this. So I can set up 2 values, and I can really just change it here in the screen. I can move it, press the key value again, and notice that it inserts another key at the second second. And that's basically it. So notice here, we've inserted 2 keys at the value 0 and the value 2. And notice how it interpolates between those 2 values. That's how we get our movement animation without writing code. However, we still have to write code. We have to let Godot know that we want to run this animation right here. And this animation's name is called test. So let's go ahead and edit the script. So in here, the play method calls the play string. And this is from the last episode, but we're going to go ahead and change this to test. And now when we press play, what you're going to notice is that we're playing the new animation we set in the animation tab. And of course, it took 2 seconds to get from the position we set for the 0 second all the way to wherever we added it in the animation tab. And that's basically it. And of course, we also have the stop method. I'm going to go ahead and uncomment that. And if we were to press play, just as you'd expect, nothing would happen because once we run this line of code with the play method, we're going to go ahead and run the animation, but exactly at the next line of code, we are calling the stop method, so we don't do anything because we don't get into the idle step. And you know what? That's basically it for this episode. I'm going to go ahead and upload this to GitHub, so please feel free to play around with the animation player and the animation tab. Now, if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to leave them in the comments section down below. Thank you for subscribing, and thank you for clicking the like button. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Have an amazing day.